WGAA Sports.
To the wall!
You can put a stamp on that one and put it to the post office. It's gone.
Searstown wins the region. Region championship. Searstown Bulldogs, the third region championship in a row.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A, 106.1 FM and AM 1340. Broadcasting online at WGAARadio.com and Facebook Live. And now, let's head down to the field for today's action.
Welcome into Cedartown High School Bulldogs baseball. The Northwest Whitfield Bruins and the Cedartown Bulldogs won game one, 9-4 here the Bulldogs did to take the series. But we reset the scoreboard and we head back to 0-0s as the Dogs are hoping Sam Branch to complete the sweep after beating them 11-2 on Monday and coming back from 4-0 down in the sixth inning with a nine spot to win it 9-4. These Bulldogs are playing some good baseball, especially here of late.
They are, and what a better time to do it right here in the heart of that region schedule. Of course, they didn't have really any problems with the Bruins at all on Tuesday, picking up that big win. But as you said, Andrew, they did have to battle back going down 4-0. They had a huge sixth inning in which the bats came alive, and then once the Bulldogs went back on defense, they were able to take care of business. So we look for the Dogs to do that again here in game two of the doubleheader, game three of the series, and it will be Cole Cochran who will get the start on the mound for the Dogs here as they look to complete the series sweep. So it will be the Dogs and the Bruins back to work. If you are just joining us, if you missed game one of the doubleheader, the Dogs wearing their home black uniforms with red script and red numbers, and the gray trousers in Northwest wearing blue jerseys and white britches as the first pitch from Cochran is fired in there for a called strike one. So Cochran ahead in the count here. No balls, one strike. As we are underway, game two of the doubleheader. Second pitch on the way, and that one is popped up. It's going to be Cochran that's going to come in from his spot on the pitcher's mound. Now it'll be Cole Dingler who will come in from first base and make the catch against Cooley for out number one.
A good play there. Dingler had the best angle on that, and he took charge, made the catch over there to retire the first out in the inning.
Defensively for Cedartown, it'll be Roper, Ware, and Formby in the outfield field from left to right, and then from third to first, Allen, Holiday, Formby, Dingler, all red behind the plate again here in game two. Pitch on the way, and that one gets past all red for ball one.
Yeah, X-Holiday started the first game of the series, went six strong innings, and then, of course,
six beautiful innings.
Yeah, Samuel Formby in game one of today's doubleheader, game two of the series, kept the Dogs in it, gave up a couple of runs in the sixth inning, and 4-0 was the score when the bats finally came alive. So the Bulldogs in good position right now. Already won the series, which they needed to do in order to stay in contention.
Cochran comes set, pitch on the way, and that one is lifted to the right side. It's going to be Samuel Formby who will drift out, and now he'll camp underneath it for out number two. So quickly, two up, two down here in the top of the first inning. That is going to bring up Scruggs. So Scruggs comes to the plate with the bases empty and two outs. Cochran looks in, gets the call from Allred, and the pitch is on the way.
Oof, that looked like a good pitch.
Yeah, that one just missed, though, for ball one.
Looked really good. No call from the home plate umpire.
1-0 on the way. Gets it that time, called strike one. One ball, one strike.
Pretty close to the same pitch that was called ball two, Sam, but or ball one, rather, but got the benefit of the call there.
And Cochran comes set. The 1-1 on the way. That one's going to be, oh, inside. Catches the inside corner, though. Strike two. We'll take it.
Yeah, Cole will definitely take that.
So Cochran ahead in the count now. One ball, two strikes. Nobody on, two out. 1-2 on the way, and that one is lifted to the right side. Again, Formby's going to have a shot at it, but this time it's going to be Caleb Formby who ventures out and makes the grab for out number three. Three up, three down. We'll go to the home half of the first inning, still scoreless here at the Doghouse. You're listening to Cedartown High School Baseball here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Make the right play. Go to Peach State Ford in Cedartown today.
Rush to Peach State Ford in Cedartown. Peach State Ford has a championship lineup of new and pre-owned vehicles. Peach State Ford is now open in your backyard.
Peach State Ford is proud to be part of your local community. Whether you're waiting for your vehicle to get serviced, picking up a part for your vehicle, or stopping by to check out a new vehicle for yourself, Peach State Ford offers a wide range of amenities to enhance your experience. Peach State Ford in Cedartown, 2076 Rockmart Highway, 770-748-3673.
Live Wire Surplus, stop in today at 546 North Main Street. New items are arriving all the time. At Live Wire, they have unbelievable deals on lawnmowers, weed eaters, and leaf blowers. But that's not all. How about your patio? Live Wire has top-of-the-line grills, patio tables and chairs, fire pits, and so much more. All fresh off the truck, brand new, still packaged, and priced to sell. Live Wire Surplus, 678-861-5021. Take your truck, you're going to need it to load up on the savings.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big AA.
Welcome back as we head to the bottom half of the first inning. Nothing doing for the Bruins in the top half. Good job there by Cole Cochran to set them down in order. The Bulldogs will bring a similar lineup to bear as we've seen. Ex-Holiday ace Allen, Tony Ware, Samuel Formby. Then Owen Jarrell is going to be the DH for Cole Cochran. Cole Dingler will bat sixth. Batting seventh will be Caleb Formby. Gavin Allred will grab a bat. He will hit for himself in this ball game. Batting eighth and batting ninth will be Jack Roper playing left field. He actually started in right field in the first game of the doubleheader, moves back over to the spot that he knows. And Sam, we're to the time of night where pop-ups and fly balls can be hard to see. It's that twilight time. The lights really can't help much on the field because of the way the lighting is from the natural lighting from the sun, which has already gone down. So could be tough for the Bruin defense here. X Holiday will lead things off, and X is definitely due. He was the only one to go 0-for-4 in the ball game in the previous ball game today in the doubleheader.
Yep, we'll take whatever help we can get. First pitch on the way from Holiday, and that one's going to be in there for a called strike one. So Holiday behind in the count. Ramsey will get the start here in game two of the doubleheader for the Bruins. 0-1 pitch on the way, and that one is going to plunk X right in the middle of the four on the backside. And so Holiday will draw the leadoff walk on the hit by a pitch, and that will bring up Ace Allen.
Any way he can get on base, X will gladly take the bag over at first base and definitely a threat to run.
Luckily, that looked like just a breaking ball that got away from Ramsey. Nothing with a lot of heat, so even though I know it still hurt, yeah, it's not as bad as it could have been for Holiday.
Sam, Ace Allen had a great ball game in the first of this doubleheader today. He got the Bulldogs' first base hit, and he's been hitting great here in the last couple of games.
We'll see how well he can do here against Ramsey. Squares the bunt, drops it down the third base side. That's a beauty. Everybody is going to be safe. Ace caught him off guard. He laid down a picture-perfect bunt down the third base line, and we've got runners at first and second with nobody out.
Coach Johnson is never afraid to lay down the bunt sign, and he did it right there. And Ace Allen is probably one of the best bunters on this team, and he was able to get the infield single. And now Tony Ware, the Dogs are wanting to put the dagger in the heart and maybe in this game early.
Well, look, I'll be fine with that as well. Cedartown, a game away from being 500 in region play with the win against Northwest here in game one of this doubleheader. They moved to 3-4 in region play, so looking to go 4-4. First pitch on the way. Shows bunt again, and X is going to swipe third. Tony would hold back on that one, but it will be a called strike one.
I'll tell you what, Sam, the Dogs have been very aggressive on the base paths, really in the first game and then of the series back on Monday, and especially today. I think we had six stolen bases in the first game of the doubleheader today. Nothing and won the count to Tony.
Ace Allen over at first, Andrew, another threat to steal as that pitch is fouled back. So Tony now in the hole, 0-2. And something that I know that this coaching staff has been thinking about throughout the season, there have been opportunities in games that we should have been more aggressive and that we should have won those games.
Yeah.
And I know for a fact, those guys know those games that got away from us as the 0-2 is on the way to Tony. He fouls that one back to stay alive. You're at a spot in the schedule now, though. You can't afford to let those games get past you. We saw that at Heritage last week. We were up 9-1. The Generals would come back and pick up a win there, 10-9. We would lose game two, which would be actually game three of the series, and would get swept by the Generals in a series where we should have won at least one, if not two, of those games.
I think you had a good chance to win all of them. Runner goes.
Everybody will have to reset as that one's fouled off to the third base side. So you know this coaching staff, I like the aggressiveness, and I think it's because they are very well aware of the fact that we've got to be aggressive when we can and pick up wins when you can, because right now we're in a situation where, at best, with Heritage playing as well as they're playing, we might be able to squeeze a second place out of the region, possibly, though, more a third, as Ace goes again, and that one again is fouled off down the third base side.
Well, and you also have to think about this. Northwest Whitfield and Heritage have both played the worst teams in the region early.
They have.
Cedartown has Southeast Whitfield and Sonoraville, the two worst teams in the region, to finish off the schedule.
Throw over to first, and Ace is back in plenty of time there, as Ramsey was very slow on that.
And it's no disrespect to the wins that Heritage and Northwest Whitfield have already had, but they have a much tougher road to a good
Ace
schedule.
Goes again, and that one is lifted to center field. It's going to be Cooley comes over. He makes the grab. Ace is going to get back to first. Nope. Not in time. So it'll be a double play on the fly out to center field and the throw out to first. But X Holiday comes in and scores from third base. So the Dogs, even though we get doubled up, we do get a run out of it and the lead with 1-0. And the base is empty for Samuel Formby. And you're right, you can't take anything away from those wins because they did what they were supposed to. They won the games they were supposed
to. Absolutely.
And when you don't do that in a season, you find yourself in a situation like the Dogs are in, where we should be, you know, what, a lot better in the region than we are right now, as Formby looks at that one over the inside for ball one.
Going back to that previous play there, just a base running mistake there by the Bulldogs. Ace Allen was standing at second base when the ball was caught, and he was dead to rights.
He was.
Missed there, 1-1 the
and
count.
It looked like the hit and run might have been on because Ace was off on the races, but still, you got to judge that one a little bit better.
But also a great throw in by Austin Cooley from center field to gun him out and get the double play. That's outside ball two, 2-1 the count. But, just to say this too, that Heritage lost to Central in their first game. Heritage won the game.
That one's ripped to the right side by Formby, and that one's going to get down for a two-out single. So Formby will trot down to first base, and that's going to bring up the designated hitter, Gerald. And you're right, they did drop that game to Central. They were leading the Lions, and the top of the seventh, it was 9-5 the last
time.
Back
to win it. They came back to win that first game of the series earlier in the week.
So, you know, anything can happen to the end of the season. It's definitely going to be hard for Cedartown to win the region, but they definitely still are alive in a home playoff berth.
Ramsey comes set. First pitch on the way to the DH, Gerald, who's been swinging a hot stick, and he hits that one right to Collins over at shortstop. They'll go the quick route to second for out number three, but the Dogs do strike for one. We will go to the top of the second inning, 1-0. Dogs on top. We'll be back after this break here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network, the Big AA.
Coverage of Cedartown High School Bulldogs baseball on the Big AA is brought to you in part by Republican State Representative Trey Kelly of Cedartown.
This is Representative Trey Kelly. I want to wish all the players and coaches a safe and successful season. You've worked hard to represent us on the field, and I'm proud to represent you in the Georgia House of Representatives. Again, this is Representative Trey Kelly, and I want to thank you for listening to the Big AA. Go Dogs!
This announcement paid for by State Representative Trey Kelly, KellyForHouse.com. Cedar Screen, the industry leader in screen-printed apparel. They offer screen printing, embroidery, and signs and banners. At CedarStream, they have a fully automated screen printing facility here in Cedartown with the ability to efficiently and effectively distribute products all over the United States. CedarStream is a local family-run business with a big vision. Contact CedarStream today to find out what they can do for you. 800-686-7488 or cedarstream.com. CedarStream, shirts, it's what we do.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big AA.
Welcome back to Bulldogs Baseball as we head to the second inning. Cedartown 1-0. Could have been more, Base running mistake ended up being a double play. The Dogs able to get one, though, in the first inning to lead 1-0, which, you know, the Dogs didn't lead in the first game of the doubleheader today until the sixth inning, but now the Bulldogs have the 1-0 lead. And we head now back to the top of the second inning with the Bruins back out on offense, and Cole Cochran will continue his work. He got him 1-2-3 in the first inning.
That's right. So it will be 4-5-6 due up. Collins, Knuckles, and Hickson. The shortstop will start things off as the throw goes down to second base into X Holiday, and we are ready to go with the shortstop, Collins. You know, the Bruins color scheme kind of reminds me of the old school Denver Broncos.
Kind of like
color
that.
Scheme. It's a little different, but it's kind of reminiscent.
I would have said almost
New York Mets.
Yeah, I was about to say New York Mets alternative, yep. Which makes me not like it at all. Or the Florida Gators.
Or even worse.
Yeah. Because they have the orange hats too, which, you know. Anyway, we digress. Let's go to the second inning.
Pitch on the way from Cochran is high and tight for ball one. Speaking of the New York Mets, they lost to the Milwaukee Brewers today. So with the Braves' win over the Phillies, they are in sole first place in the NL East. Second pitch is upstairs as well for ball two.
Yeah, they were
two.
The only NL East team to win their opening game, right?
Yes, they were, sir. Yes, they were.
Yeah, the Nationals and the Marlins all lost. Yep.
The Nats lost to the Reds.
Yesterday.
The Marlins lost to the Pirates.
But yeah, the Pirates.
Two balls, no strikes on Collins, the shortstop. Cochran comes set, pitch on the way in there, called strike one. So good pitch there from Dirty.
Well, anytime the Mets and the Phillies can lose on the same day, I'm a happy man.
I'm a happy, happy man. 2-1. That one misses low, ball three. So three balls, one strike. Now the count on Collins. Cochran has to battle here. The 3-1 on the way, and that one is lifted to the left side, and that one is going to be foul. So the count will go full. Three balls and two strikes.
You know, we're talking about the region schedule. Cedartown takes a break from the region next week, but we do face future region foes. We'll talk about that here in a moment after this 3-2 pitch.
Payoff pitch on the way from Cochran. Swing in the dirt. And the throw down to first, and the tag is applied easily by Dingler for out number one. So Collins is down on a swinging strikeout, and that will bring up Gavin Knuckles, the right fielder. I called his name quite a bit over the PA system during football season this year, and every time I got ready to call his name, I wanted to say, is that really his name?
It's a great name.
Pitch on the way from Cochran, it is.
That's a great name. One ball, no strikes, that missed up. Didn't he play basketball, too?
He did. He played. Yep, he's at least a triathlete. Is Knuckles. Pitch on the way from Cochran, and that's in there called strike one. One ball, one strike now the count on the Bruins right fielder. I don't think he was first team on basketball, though. I think he was a sub, but still, he did get some playing time because we did call his name. 1-1 the count. Pitch on the way. That one is upstairs. Knuckles thought about it, but he was able to hold up on that one that was up in the zone.
Talk about the schedule next week. Battle for Bartow, Cedartown starts out with Woodland on Thursday at 7 p.m. Future region member next year. Then Whitewater and Cartersville doubleheader on Friday.
2-1, swing and a miss from Knuckles. Strike two, that'll even up the count. I'll have the call on Thursday, and then Andrew Carter will have the call for the two games on Friday.
Yeah,
so
radio only for Thursday.
Yep, because I do not know how to operate all of the camera equipment. I'll just be quite honest with you folks. 2-2 the pitch, and that one gets past all red, so the count will now be full. Three balls and two strikes. I'm not afraid to admit it, I am not the most technologically advanced person of my era, age group. I'm just not. I can do the bare minimum and then a little bit more, and that's it. Payoff pitch on the way from Cochran, misses. Ball four. So that will be the first base runner for the Bruins, and it's courtesy of a one-out walk to the right fielder, Gavin Knuckles, and this will bring up Hickson, the third baseman. And he comes to the plate with one out and one on. A perfect time for a double play for the Dogs. A quick 1-2-3 first inning for Cochran.
You know, we didn't have a 4-6-3 or a 6-4-3 double play in the game, but we did have a 5-3 double play across the horn.
First pitch is fouled off from Hickson. Behind in the count now, 0-1.
It was a ground ball that came to Caleb Formby, who was playing over at third base, and he threw a strike to first. Tagged the bag on the force. That missed outside, 1-1. So the Dogs defensively, although we did have a couple errors in the first game, have really cleaned things up.
Sweet 16 is in action again tonight, Andrew. NC State leads Marquette 37-24 at the half. 1-1 pitch on the way. That one's in the dirt. That one's going to get away from Allred, and the runner will move up. So Knuckles now stands at second base, and Hickson is ahead in the count, 2-1.
It's been a tough tournament for the SEC, and my bracket was destroyed.
Busted on every level.
Every level, it's destroyed.
Purdue leads Gonzaga right now, 28-24. The Boilermakers trying to redeem themselves after going out in round one last year against the 16th-seeded Fairleigh Dickinson, who may not have even made the NIT this year. I don't know.
Georgia did, and they're in the
semifinals.
They're
in the Final Four, aren't they?
Yeah. Beat Ohio State to get to the semifinals.
Kentucky, really, they were the first ones to mess everybody up. And then Auburn messed everybody up with their early exit against
Yale. Auburn was my pick to win it all.
I got messed up with Baylor as well. 2-1 pitch on the way. That one's high and tight for 4-3.
That's why they call it March Madness.
That's it, baby.
It's mad.
Right now, the Dogs with a 1-0 lead over the Bruins, but Cole Cochran behind in the count. 3-1 on Hickson. Pitch on the way, swing and a miss. A big cut there by Hickson comes up empty. So the count once again full, and Cochran second straight time of the inning. He's got a full count and has battled back. The last time he issued a walk, we'll see what he does here. Pitch on the way, and he issues a walk there. So back-to-back walks by Cochran have put runners at first and second.
But, Sam, I've been so happy today because Major League Baseball is back. The Braves are back, and they won today. Yep. I'm a happy camper.
And although it did not feel like baseball weather in Philadelphia, it absolutely felt like baseball weather here today.
Why couldn't they open the season here? It's been about 6 years.
That first pitch misses out of the zone for 1-1 from Cochran. Second straight year that the Braves have had to open the season on the road in Philadelphia. I believe we beat them in the season opener up there last year.
We did indeed. I think we only lost one game at Philly in the regular season last year.
Pitch on the way, and that one misses. If memory serves me correctly, according to Joe Simpson, I believe that the Braves went 8-5 against Philadelphia in the regular season last year, 5-1 against the Phillies on the road. Does that sound right?
That sounds right. That's where I heard it.
Were we listening to the same broadcast?
Yeah, we were listening. We were.
My goodness.
We were.
Coaches visit, I have to say, to the pitcher's mound as Coach Smith is out to talk to Cochran. Just want to make sure he's still good to go. Of course, Cole has been a weapon for the Dogs on the mound. He had a very good, quick 1-2-3 first inning. But here he's run into a little bit of trouble after retiring the first hitter he saw. He has now walked back-to-back guys to put runners at first and second with one out, and he's fallen behind here, 2-0. It's the designated hitter, Crossan.
Sam Crossan was the starting pitcher in the first game of the series, and then he came in and pitched in relief in the end of the first game today. So he's probably used up as far as being a pitcher.
So we've got Sam Crossan at the plate, we've got Samuel Formby in right field, and you got Sam Branch in the broadcast booth. The only Sam we're missing is Green Eggs and Ham or Sam Hunt.
Sam Houston.
Could be. Sammy Davis Jr., that one's fouled back. 2-1 the count on the DH.
Samuel L. Jackson, he's not here.
Pitch on the way from Cole Cochran, and once again, that one's fouled off. So after jumping ahead in the count, 2-0, Crossan has found himself with the count now even at 2-2.
Hold on to your butts. Classic line from a classic movie.
2-2 the count, and that one is going to miss upstairs. And once again, Cochran now has the count full.
Yeah, it's so crazy.
3-2.
It's so crazy, Sam, because you're right. Cole was just so efficient in the first inning, and he got that first out, but he just is having trouble finding the zone now.
And that one is ripped down the left side, but it is foul. I tell you what, had that one been fair, it would have been trouble, but thankfully it is not, and we'll have to reset and do it all again with the count full, 3-2.
That ball was smoked.
They did. Payoff pitch on the way. Called strike 3, and that's the second out of the inning.
Buckle his knees.
What
good
a
pitch.
What a battle there by Cole Cochran to come back and pick up that second out. A big second out as the Bruins with runners at first and second. The Dogs with a 1-0 lead trying to hold on to that, and it'll bring up the catcher, Edwards.
Oh, he threw him that breaking ball, and he just looked at it. I mean, it just buckled his knees, just completely locked him up.
Pitch on the way. That one is skied to shallow center field. It will be X Holiday who comes over from his spot at shortstop to record out number 3. So the Bruins threaten, but they leave 2 on. The Dogs lead as we go to the home half of the second. 1-0, your score. We'll be back after this break here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Hey, it's the Border Mexican Restaurant located at 718 North Main Street right here in Cedartown. Their phone number, 678-246-1031. They serve a wide variety of your favorite Mexican food made fresh daily. Great food, great fun. It's great for the whole family. Come see us at the Border Restaurant right here on Main Street in Cedartown. Or you can call for takeout at 678-246-1031. The Border Mexican Restaurant is the best Mexican food north of the border. That's the Border Restaurant right here in Cedartown.
Bradford's Drug Store on North Main Street in Cedartown is your locally owned and operated Good Neighbor Pharmacy. Bradford's accepts most prescription plans, and remember Bradford's for all of your gift and decor needs. Bradford's pharmacist takes time to get to know you, explain your medication, and answer any questions that you may have. Go by and see Bill Brewster and all the fine folks at Bradford's the next time you need a prescription filled. Also use their convenient drive-thru. Bradford's Drug Store, 500 North Main Street, Cedartown, 770-748-3100. And all the folks at Bradford's say, go Dogs.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Back here to the Dog Pound. Dogs lead 1-0. It'll be Dingler, Formby, and Allred. That's Cole Dingler, Caleb Formby, and Gavin Allred. Do you up 6, 7, and 8? Dogs lead it 1-0 on 2 hits and a bunch of zeros on the board for Northwest Whitfield in the top there as the Bulldogs will come here as. As the Bulldogs, you had Cochran out there. Cochran was having some trouble. But once again, Sam, the defense, able to bail him out there. He induced a pop-up with 2 on and was able to get that final out.
Defense had just not given up on yourself and just battling back time after time, and that's exactly what the Dogs have got to continue to do. And we will go to the home half of the second inning, and it'll be Dingler, Formby, and Allred new up. So 6, 7, 8 new up. Home half of the second. Little old school walk-up songs from a couple of the guys. I love it. First pitch on the way to Dingler is on the way, and that one is drilled to the left side. The left fielder is going to have to turn and give chase, and that one's going to get all the way to the fence. Dingler around first. He's going to go into second base, and Cole Dingler will be in with a leadoff stand-up double, and once again, the Dogs are in business here against the Bruins.
That ball was smacked out there to left field. I think the left fielder really, I mean, he was playing him pretty shallow. I'm kind of shocked that he was, knowing the big bat he's got. But, hey, take advantage of that. Lead off double, and here's Caleb Formby now, hoping to drive him in. Dogs up 1-0, but would love to get some more.
So Ramsey with the look in to Edwards with the sign, checks the runner at second, comes set. Now pitch on the way. They show bunt, and it is laid down to the first base side beautifully. They will throw on to first for out number 1, and Dingler moves up safely to third, and the Dogs playing small ball here. Any way you can get them.
I'll tell you what, Caleb almost beat that thing out.
He did. He was on the move, buddy.
He was absolutely motoring down the line toward first base. Gavin Allred will be the batter. He was DH'd for in the first game, but he will take a bat and swing for himself here in this one with Cole Cochran getting the DH.
First pitch on the way, and that's a swing and a miss for strike number 1 against Allred. So the Dogs with runner in scoring position, looking to add to the 1-0 lead. Ramsey comes set, kicks, fires, pitch is lined over to the right side and foul. So all red in the hole, 0-2.
All right, middle up. Right.
Pitch on the way to the Bulldogs catcher. That one missed low. Ball one. One ball, two strikes. Runner at third and one out. Ramsey comes set. Pitch on the way. That one's going to miss outside. Ball two. So after quickly falling behind 0-2, Allred has evened it up to two balls and two strikes. Time is called by the home plate umpire, and now I think we're ready to go back to work. So Allred will dig in. And the pitch is on the way. That one's going to miss it. Three balls, two strikes. Count now full. So Ramsey having some difficulty after jumping ahead. He's fallen behind, and the count is even. Payoff pitch on the way. That one's going to miss. Ball four. So a great at-bat there by Gavin Allred, who fell behind in the count 0-2. Takes four straight pitches and has a one-out walk, and the Dogs have them on the corners, and that'll bring up the left fielder, Jack Roper. We're going to have a courtesy runner come out, it looks like, as Coach Johnson comes out and talks to the home plate umpire, and we will.
That's not a bad at-bat at all for someone who doesn't really get to
not
have at-bats that much. This is going to be number 11, Yarbrough, will go over there and run. Jacob Yarbrough will run for the catcher, Allred. So the Dogs in business here with one out. And here's a senior, Jack Roper.
Yarbrough over at first. Dingler still at third. Roper to the plate. Ramsey kicks, fires. First pitch on the way. That one is fouled back from Roper. And he is behind in the count, 0-1.
Tell you what, it was nice and comfortable this afternoon. The sun's gone down. The temperature is starting to kind of drop a bit.
Well, and I looked at my forecast earlier, and it said that the temperature was going to drop pretty quickly. I think at 7, it was supposed to have been around 70, and then at 8, it was going to be all the way down to like 64 and then just continuing to drop. Oh, and they've got us picked off. Yarbrough took off, and now we're in a rundown. The runner's going to come from third, and Dingler is going to be thrown out at the plate. Dingler was going to try to steal one. They had Yarbrough in a rundown. He got picked off, was going to be picked off, but instead the play is at the plate. The runner from third is thrown out at home, and there's two outs. And Yarbrough will move up to second base, but at the cost of Cole Dingler over at third.
Yeah, that might have been a design job there to score that run, and you got to tip your hat to Northwest Whitfield for picking up on that and getting that out at the plate to keep the game at one run.
They just played fundamental baseball right there. Pitch on the way from Ramsey, 0-1 the count. That one's inside, and it's going to get past the catcher. And so Yarbrough is now going to stand at third base. There are two outs in the inning now, and Roper has an even count at one ball and one strike.
Also, you think about that, if that play does not happen, it's a 2-0 game right now after that wild pitch.
1-1 pitch on the way, lifted to the right side. It's going to be Scruggs, the first baseman, who's going to make the play on the line, and that will be out number three. So a base running error, and then we leave one. We will go to the top of the third, 1-0. The Dogs on top. We'll be back after this 60-second break here on the Big AA.
Cedar Valley Golf Course has been the place to play golf in Cedar Town and Polk County for nearly a century. Locally owned and operated since 1924, Cedar Valley Golf Course offers 18 holes of some of the most beautiful fairways and greens in the area. Cedar Valley Golf Course is a proud supporter of the Cedar Town High School Bulldogs and the greater Cedar Town and Polk County region. Call for tee time, 770-748-9671, located just south of Cedar Town at 1811 Buckhannon Highway. Cedar Town's original golf course, Cedar Valley Golf Course. Cedar Town Automotive is your one stop for all your automotive needs. For oil changes, new tires, or tire repair, brake work, tune-ups, air conditioner service, or repair, think of Cedar Town Automotive. Cedar Town Automotive is a longtime supporter of Cedar Town High School Athletics here on WGAA. Cedar Town Automotive on East Avenue in Cedar Town. Give them a call today at 770-749-5040 or stop by their beautiful location for fast and friendly service. And all the folks at Cedar Town Automotive say, go Dogs!
Cedar Town High School Baseball is on the Big AA.
Back here to Cedartown High School Baseball and the Cedartown Bulldog Sports Network, along with my broadcast partner, Sam Branch, Andrew Carter, with you here from the Dog Pound on a beautiful night for baseball. Dogs lead 1-0 on three hits, no errors, still no hits for Northwest Woodfield as we get to the top half of the third inning. The Bruins, let's see, who are they going to? They're going to
should be 9-1-2.
Yeah, 9-1-2 will beat you up. Winch will be Harrison, Cooley, and then Spates. So he'll face, of course, Cochran, and we're waiting here to get the pitch thrown, I think. And there we go. Throw goes down to second base, and here we go for the third inning. Cedartown had a chance to add another run, but as you mentioned before, the delayed steal backfired on us, and we were out at home plate. And then after a wild pitch, which could have given us another run after that pickoff move, the inning ended on a pop-out. So here we are in the top of the third.
It'll be Harrison, the left fielder. Cochran ready to go to work. First pitch on the way from Cole. Misses ball one. We were talking during the break. There is some baseball going on tonight. The Bronx Bombers are in Houston. Pitch on the way. That's in there. Called strike one. Catches the inner part of the plate. So the count now even at 1-1. Several other games will be in action tonight. If you have access to those games, whether it's Amazon Prime, which you have, or whatever else.
By hook or by crook.
There you go. 2-1. The count is that one misses against Harrison. Of course, I like to go old school. I like to pull the ball on Sirius XM and listen to the radio broadcast. 2-1 is pop to the right side. Long run for Dingler. He's going to come in and make the play in foul territory for out number one. Good play there by the Bulldogs first baseman to record out number one, and we will go back to the top of the order in Cooley, the center fielder.
Of course, if you listen to the Yankees radio broadcast, you get to hear former Atlanta Braves announcer John Sterling, who has been the Yankees announcer for quite some time.
Yep.
The Yankees win, you know.
Yep.
Which and it's, made me throw up in my mouth a little bit when I said. But,
and I like it know. Because you can pick which team's broadcast you want to listen
Absolutely.
To.
Absolutely.
Pitch on the way from Cochran. That one's taken inside on Cooley for ball number one. So, earlier in the day when the Brewers and the Mets were playing, I listened to that game because they started about an hour before the Braves started, and I bet you can't guess which broadcast I listened to. That one is ripped to the left side, and that one's going to get down, and it's going to be extra bases for Cooley. He's going to round first on his way to second, and the
nice throw in.
Center fielder will be in there with a stand-up double.
Cooley was hitting the ball hard in the first game of this series, Sam, on Monday. And, again, he did the same thing he did against the Bulldogs a couple of times, depositing it left field there in the corner. But, again, that great arm of Jack Roper, he gets to that ball quickly, and he got it in. And he wasn't going to get him, but he made it close.
He did. So Cooley stands at second, and that will bring up Spates, the second baseman who is 0-1. Cochran looks in, checks the runner at second, and now the pitch is on the way. That one misses outside. Good stop there by Allred as that one's in the dirt. Ball one.
So whose broadcast were you listening
Not
to?
Not the Mets.
Not the Mets.
There are so many other things in life I would rather do, such as pull my toenails off with a pair of pliers, walk barefoot across a charcoal grill.
Point made.
Pitch on the way. They show bunt. But he has to bring it back, but it is a called strike one. So the count now even, 1-1. Allred popped up. Cooley thought about heading on down to third base, but quickly changed his mind. And so the count now even at 1-1. I would rather drink unsweet tea.
Oh, man.
I'm telling you. 1-1 the count. Pitch on the way. That one, again, is in the dirt. Another good stop there by Allred, and it is a 2-1 count.
Unsweet tea without lemon.
Without lemon or ice.
That's like drinking mud water.
Ugh.
I'd rather have water than drink unsweet.
Well, you know, we fought a whole war just so we wouldn't have to drink hot, unsweet tea. But I have to admit, a good cup of hot tea is nice every now and then. But I got to put a little bit of lemon and a little bit of honey in it.
Absolutely.
2-1 the count. Cochran checks the runner at second. Pitch on the way. Swing and a miss, and the count's now even at 2 balls and 2 strikes on the Bruins' second baseman.
Cochran 2 in the third inning so far with 1 hit allowed. A couple of walks and a couple of strikeouts. That double he just gave up was his first hit allowed.
2-2 the count, and the pitch is on the way. Swing and a miss, strike 3. And Spates is down on strikes, 0-2 on the night. And that'll be the second out of the inning, and it will bring up the first baseman, Scruggs, who is 0-1. Hank Scruggs. Now, that's a baseball name. If it's not a baseball name, it's an old-timey country music singer.
I love it.
Combination of Hank Williams and Earl Scruggs. Hank Scruggs. Does he pick a banjo? Pitch on the way. That one's in the dirt. Good stop by Allred. The runner's going to try for third, and he's going to be there as Allred mishandles the ball there and not able to make a throw down to third base. So Cooley stands at third base, and the Bruins are threatening here in the top of the third inning. Dogs still on top, 1-0. Cole Cochran trying to keep the Bruins at bay. Pitch on the way. That one's in the dirt again. Good stop there by Allred. And it is now 2-0 on Scruggs.
No strike. Get this guy out. Come on.
Not to be confused with Scrubs, which was a very popular song by TLC back in the, what, early 2000s?
Sounds right.
I don't want no Scrubs. 2-0 the count. Pitch on the way. That one's going to get away from Allred, and we're going to be tied. 3 straight pitches in the dirt from Cochran, and the third one finally gets away from Allred, and we are tied up here in the top of the third inning, 1-1.
Well, the Bruins cash in the double. Base is now empty, but still the count is now 3-0 on the batter, Scruggs.
Okay, did my eyes deceive me? Is that pitch calm in his ear?
Oh, that. I've seen pitch comm in a lot of places.
But I didn't know that we had it.
Do we have it?
I feel like he's got it in his left ear. 3-0 the count on Scruggs. Pitch on the way, and that one's going to hit him. And he will go down to first base. So
I think he just left his AirPod in.
No, look at that. Look at that big pack on his. See it on his left side?
Huh.
It's pitch comm.
Well.
It's pitch comm. Pitch comm. We have entered the 21st century.
As long as they don't put a pitch clock out there, I'll be happy.
Well, we're tied here in the top of the third at 1 run apiece as the Bruins were able to cash in that double on a wild pitch. And now a hit batsman puts Scruggs down at first base. And this will bring up Collins, who is 0-1 with a strikeout. The Bruins shortstop. God bless you.
What a beautiful night. Beautiful sunset.
It is shaping up to be a, God bless you, beautiful Easter weekend. Good Friday, of course, today.
A lot of Easter egg hunts tomorrow. Going to be perfect weather for that.
Pitch on the way, a swing and a foul ball straight back. So Collins is in the hole 0-1.
Going to be probably low 80s for Easter Sunday in the afternoon. That's going to be great.
I think it
will be. It's going to be great. Could have some storms on Tuesday. No games early in the week, though, for Cedartown. We don't play again until Thursday.
Cochran comes set. Pitch on the way. That breaking ball misses. Ball one.
You know, it seems like sometimes Cole will just kind of alter his delivery a little bit. And when he does that, it kind of alters where his pitches are going. And I'm not sure if it's just he kind of normally does that sometimes, but a lot of times when he's struggling, he'll just try to change something up and he'll overcorrect.
That one is lifted to the right side, and it's going to be a long run for Formby, who's on his horse, turns, and makes the catch for out number 3.
That was a Willie Mays kind of catch.
Yes, it was. Formby in right field saved a run, and the Dogs will head to the home half of the third with this one tied up at 1 run apiece. We'll be back after this break here on the Big Double A, the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Looking for a good used vehicle?
Don't go out of town. Come see the folks at Dingler Motor Company, 526 North Main Street. Bad credit, no credit, no problem. Dingler Motor Company can get you back on the road in no time with their in-house financing. Top quality pre-owned late model cars, trucks, and SUVs. Stop by and check out their wide selection at 526 North Main Street across from Live Wire Surplus. Call them at 770-748-0906. Search them on Facebook at Dingler Motor Co. That's Dingler Motor Company.
Rocky and Patty Tillery, two Cedartown High School graduates, and they stayed right here in the county and went into business. They employ right at 100 people, and they've been doing that for a long time. Most of their work is from out of the county, but they want to push our youngsters here, no matter what they're doing, Little League, Pony League, high school baseball, basketball, football, and soccer. And that's Polk County Public Service. They appreciate serving you.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Welcome back to Cedartown Bulldogs Baseball on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network. We're tied 1-1 as we head to the bottom half of the third inning for the Bulldogs. And X Holiday will lead it off. It'll be the top of the lineup, 1, 2, and 3 for the Bulldogs. X Holiday followed by Ace Allen and Tony Ware. And the Dogs, we're in the new ballgame, 1-1. I wanted to say one more thing about that catch in right field by Samuel Formby when I mentioned Willie Mays kind of catch. If you remember when Willie Mays in center field at the old Polo Grounds made that catch 40 feet out in center field, had his back turned to it.
X lifts that one down the left side. It's going to be a long run for Harrison. That one is going to drop.
Fair.
And Holiday is going to have extra bases.
He overran it.
He's going to be
loose
into second, and he's going to come to third. And X Holiday is going to be in there with a leadoff triple.
Boy, he needed that, Sam. He has just not been able to have any luck today. And, boy, I tell you what, laid that one down out there, and I think it was overran and then even kicked it when he was trying to get to it over there in left field was Harrison. A triple and the go-ahead run 90 feet away for Ace Allen.
It was going to be a double regardless, and then the mistake in Harrison in left field turned it into a triple, and that's going to be good news for the Dogs here in the home half of the third. Ace Allen will come to the plate. First pitch on the way from Ramsey. That one's in the dirt. It's going to get away, and the Dogs lead. 2-1 your score. X Holiday doing it all by himself for the Dogs. What a tale of two pitches there for Ramsey. Holiday delivers on the big leadoff triple and then scores on the wild pitch. And the Dogs are up 2-1. Ace Allen ahead in the count. 1-1, no strikes. Pitch on the way from Ramsey. And that one's going to be lifted to the right side and foul. So the count now even on the Bulldogs' third baseman, Ace Allen. And, you know, you mentioned about how well Ace has been hitting here recently. We have seen Ace do that at times. He'll get really hot from the plate. He did that when we were down in Brunswick. 1-1 the count, pitch on the way. That one's hit to the right side, and he's done it again as Allen has a single. And he's done it here in this series against the Bruins. Heating up from the plate, and that's exactly what we need, is the Dogs' bats to come alive. And so Cedartown, again, with a runner on, one run already across, and that'll bring up Tony Ware, who is 0-for-1 with an RBI.
Well, I'll tell you what, Sam, talking about how the chance the Dogs have, I mean, yeah, this game is a long way from over, but we've taken 2 out of 3 already. And if the Dogs could, I mean, 2 of 3 is big, especially against a team that was 6-0 in region play that only lost 2 games all season long.
Yep.
I mean, it just goes on to show you that this Bulldogs team can compete with just about anybody. It just depends on how things go. Another rundown, but he's going to be safe at second base.
He got in there. He got in there,
sure
Ace
did.
Allen. And the good thing about this situation with Ace, this time versus the last rundown, Ace just said, I'm going. I'm just going, and I'm going to – the only chance that I've got is to beat out the throw, and that's exactly what he did. So Ace with the stolen base out at second base, time called for and granted by the home plate umpire.
Well, you know, one thing, the reason why they're being so aggressive at the on the base paths, you know, Deacon Edwards, I know he's a great baseball player, but he's not been able to throw anybody out today.
That one has dropped. But Ace will not advance on the drop baseball as it just kind of died right there in front of Edwards. So Tony Ware ahead in the count now, one ball and no strike. And you don't want to pick on the guy, but at the same time, you have to.
Oh, you take advantage of everything you can.
You play to your strengths. And right now, our strengths are picking up a couple of stolen bases here or there. Step off from Ramsey, and Allen is back at second base with no throw. And unfortunately, we have seen that before. We have seen teams play us like that. We have played teams like that. And that's going to be another base hit for Tony Ware, and it might score another run. Allen is around third. The throw in. We'll go to second instead. And the Dogs are on top, 3-1. Tony Ware delivers once again. That's his second RBI of the game. And the Dogs are up by two here in the bottom of the third inning, a two-run third so far, and it's 3-1 with Tony Ware out at second base, and still nobody out in the inning.
Yeah, outstanding. This inning is kind of shaping up to be kind of like the bottom of the sixth in game one of this doubleheader today. Just one hit after another, things went wrong. Of course, I think in left field, the ball got past the left fielder. Center fielder was there to back it up, though. But by the time that had happened, the runner got to second.
Samuel Forby hits the first pitch that he sees, skies it to the second baseman. It'll be Spates to come in, and he drops it. It is dropped on the dirt. And so Formby will reach. And the Dogs now have runners at first and second and nobody out, and it will bring up the designated hitter, Owen Jarrell.
Well, Sam, that's just – you can't blame the twilight for that. I mean, it's all – the sky's already black.
You can't blame the wind for it?
That was just a mistake.
Just a mistake, and they happen.
Yeah.
They happen. Now we'll see how Northwest responds. First baseman playing in on the grass. And Jarrell lays down the bunt. The first baseman was ready. Nobody is covering first, and everybody is going to be safe. Once again, yeah. Unfortunately, the second baseman for the Bruins makes a mistake, doesn't come over to cover the bag, and the bases are full of Dogs, and nobody's out.
And again, like we said before in game one, Coach Johnson is never afraid. Yeah, we said it earlier in this game, never afraid to lay down a bunt. And the infield defense did not expect that. They completely were off kilter.
Well, the first baseman, I think, did because he was already playing well in on the grass, but Spates never moved
over.
Yeah,
the middle infielders did not.
They did not. So that'll bring up Cole Dingler. He comes to the plate with the bases full of Dogs and a chance to bust this one wide open here in the bottom of the third. First pitch on the way. That's inside. Ball one on the Bulldogs' first baseman, Cole Dingler. Dingler 1-for-1 on the night here in game two of the doubleheader. Game three of the series. The Dogs looking for the sweep. That one is a chopper back to the pitcher's mound. They will come home for the first out, fire on to first, and he is there for out number two. So a 1-2-3
wow.
Double play. And just like that,
that was
the Bruins a little bit of life.
Well, was he out at first? That was my question. I mean, the out at home play was definitely right, but not too sure about the one at first. But the opinion that matters says it's out number two. Now, Samuel Formby will try to keep the inning going.
Caleb Formby.
I'm sorry, Caleb. We're bottom of the order now.
Pitch on the way to Formby and is lifted foul. So Caleb is behind in the count now, 0-1. Yeah, I will say this. It was awfully close. That's all I'm going to say. It was awfully close.
It was. That it was.
Pitch on the way from Ramsey, and that one is foul tipped into the pitch, or to the catcher's glove. So count now 0-2 on Formby. Jarrell stands out at second base. Samuel Formby at third. Caleb Formby at the plate. 0-2 the count. Pitch on the way. That one's going to miss. Ball one. So the count, one ball, two strikes on the Bulldogs' second baseman. Ramsey fires in, and that one is lifted to center field. It's going to be a play for Cooley, who will drift back and make the catch for out number three, but not before the Dogs are able to strike for two. 3-1 is your score. We'll go to the top of the fourth. We'll be back after this quick break here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Have you been to Croker's Hardware and Supply lately? Croker's is the place to find everything you need, from boots to fencing, from plumbing supplies to wood and gas stove fittings, everything, even paint and flooring. Whether you're building or repairing, everything you need is right here at Croker's Hardware on East Avenue. Name brands galore right here in your back door. Orca and Yeti coolers and tumblers, Case knives, Native eyewear, Buck stove grills, and more. At Croker's, you can find everything.
Go by and see the friendly staff there at 1192 Rock Mart Highway. That's Croker's Hardware in Cedartown.
Attention high school sports fans, are you an armchair official? You know, the parent or fan who constantly yells at the referees and loves to let everyone know just how bad you think they are. Well, if you think you could do better, then get in the game and prove it. It's time for you to suit up and make the calls where they actually count. Every sport in Georgia needs more officials. Sign up today at highschoolofficials.com.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Cedartown leads 3-1 as we head to the fourth inning. Dogs able to take the lead in the bottom half. A couple of runs come across. You know, we talked about it when we scored that run in the bottom half of the first. There could have been more. There could have been more in the bottom of the third as well. But, you know, you're glad to have what you can have. And we have a new pitcher. Looks like the Dogs are going to put out there number 10, O'Neill, is going to get to pitch here. So the night will be over for Cole Cochran. Cochran goes three innings, gives up one hit, one run, no earned runs, two walks and three strikeouts. So they're going to give Jay O'Neill a chance to get some live experience here in a 3-1 game. But I would imagine, you know, control has been an issue for him, Sam, since he's come back. But the only way to work through that is to work it out in gameplay.
That is. He did not have a good outing up against Heritage up in Ringgold last week, so we'll see how well he's able to go here. I think he only went two innings in that outing against the Generals. He inherits a 3-1 lead here against Northwest as the Dogs are looking to complete the series sweep. Cedartown now 3-4 in region play. The Bruins have fallen to 6-2. Hopefully going to make it 6-3. Cedartown trying to get to a even 4-4 in region play. It'll be Gavin Knuckles, Hickson, and Crossan, the middle part of the order for the Bruins due up here in the top of the fourth inning. And it looks like we are ready to go here with Jay O'Neill on the mound. First pitch on the way from O'Neill. Misses. Ball one. O'Neill, of course, had Tommy John surgery last year. Pitch on the way. And that's a swing and a miss, strike one on Knuckles.
Yeah, that kind of pitch there from O'Neill is one that he is really, you know, that's what he's known for, that big fastball.
1-1 the count, pitch on the way. That one misses low, ball two.
His thing is the control, and he's got to, and that comes back, and that'll be back, but control has been his issue here. There's nothing wrong with the stuff.
And that one is fouled off. I think Knuckles wants that one back.
Oh, he'd love to have it back.
But he's not going to get it back, and it's going to be an even count now at two balls and two strikes on the Bruins' right fielder.
11 minutes to go in the second half. NC State leading Marquette 46-34.
Called strike three on Knuckles, and that'll be the first out. O'Neill went with that double hitch leg kick on that 2-2 pitch, kind of mess with the rhythm, and Knuckles is down on strikes, and that'll bring up Hickson. I tell you, NC State making a heck of a run. They made a charge through the ACC tournament. They knocked off the North Carolina Tar Heels in that championship game, and they have taken the March Madness bracket by storm as O'Neill is firing on all cylinders here against Hickson as he locates that one for called strike one. Jay working quickly. Pitch on the way. Strike two. I did not have NC State getting out of the first round because I thought they probably gave everything that they had to give in that ACC tournament.
I'm glad you're wrong. I'm glad I was wrong,
I am, too. Pitch on the way, and that one is fouled off. He'll stay alive. This was NC State's first ACC tournament championship since 1987.
Unreal.
They have not won a national championship since 1984, back when the legendary Jim Valvano, or Jimmy V as most sports fans know him as, led the Wolfpack to that historic run and national championship back in 84 for the Wolfpack. Pitch on the way, and that one misses. So O'Neill now with a count of 1-2 on Hickson. Of course, Marquette is one of those teams that you don't hear about unless it's basketball season. That one misses in the dirt, ball two, but they always seem to be kind of hanging around. Tennessee and Creighton will be the nightcap tonight. Tennessee, the only other SEC team still alive in the tournament. Alabama defeated the Tar Heels last night to advance to the Elite Eight for the first time since 2008, if I'm not mistaken. Maybe even 2004, actually, might be the last time that the Tide were in the Elite Eight. Count even here on Hickson, though. 2-2. Called strike three from O'Neill, wow. And back-to-back strikeouts by Jay O'Neill, and there's two outs in the inning.
Listen, I'm glad he got that call, but, man, that was a gift. That was a gift of a call. I think it was thrown so hard that he just didn't see it. I mean, it just popped up there in the glove. His velocity is getting back up there, Sam, and that's good to see. He didn't want to get too much too quickly, because he's only, 13 months, almost 14 months removed from having his Tommy John surgery. And a lot of athletes, it takes them about 16 months to get back to full strength.
It does. It does indeed. And we want to see that rehab happen the way that it's supposed to and not to be rushed, because you don't want to mess up anything that they've gone in and fixed. It'll be the DH, Sam Crossan, who takes a ball, looks like it was low, maybe 1-0. Purdue leads Gonzaga 40-36 at the half. Pitch on the way, swing and a miss from Crossan, and that will even the count at 1-1. Houston and Duke getting underway in about 50 minutes. Pitch on the way from O'Neill, that one misses low. 2-1, and then, like I said, the nightcap will be Tennessee and Creighton with tip off set for 10:09 on TBS. Pitch on the way from O'Neill. Swing and a miss. Strike two.
O'Neill looking sharp right now.
Crossing with already 1 on the night. In danger of picking up his second one here. 2-2. Nobody on. 2-2. Pitch on the way. That one's a chopper up to the pitcher's mound. O'Neill will field and fire on to first for out number 3. What an inning by Jay O'Neill. He retires them in order. We will go to the home half of the 4th. The Dogs lead 3-1. We'll be back after this break here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Make the right play. Go to Peach State Ford in Cedartown today.
Rush to Peach State Ford in Cedartown. Peach State Ford has a championship lineup of new and pre-owned vehicles. Peach State Ford is now open in your backyard.
Peach State Ford is proud to be part of your local community. Whether you're waiting for your vehicle to get service, picking up a part for your vehicle, or stopping by to check out a new vehicle for yourself, Peach State Ford offers a wide range of amenities to enhance your experience. Peach State Ford in Cedartown, 2076 Rockmart Highway, 770-748-3673.
Live Wire Surplus. Stop in today at 546 North Main Street. New items are arriving all the time. At LiveWire, they have unbelievable deals on lawnmowers, weed eaters, and leaf blowers. But that's not all. How about your patio? LiveWire has top-of-the-line grills, patio tables and chairs, fire pits, and so much more. All fresh off the truck, brand new, still packaged, and priced to sell. LiveWire Surplus, 678-861-5021. Take your truck. You're going to need it to load up on the savings.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Three to one lead for the Bulldogs. 3 runs on 7 hits, no errors. Northwest Whitfield, 1 run, 1 hit, 1 error.
good inning for Jay O'Neill, looking as sharp as we've seen him all season long since returning from the injured list after having that Tommy John surgery last February. And the Dogs with a 3-1 lead here as we head to the bottom half of the fourth inning. Sam Branch, Andrew Carter with you here from the ballpark. And
it's Friday Night Baseball. And it is Friday Night Baseball everywhere.
Everywhere.
It's the best Friday night of the year so far. The Rays lead the Blue Jays down in Tampa Bay 6-1. The Pirates on top of the Marlins in South Beach 4-1. Those dirty, rotten, rascal, cheating Astros lead the Yankees 1-0 in the top of the third. First pitch on the way here. Misses against Allred. Ball one. The Dogs lead 3-1, though, and that's the most important score of the night. Pitch on the way from Ramsey. That one's fouled back. You know, when the Astros and the Yankees play, it's kind of one of those situations of who do you want to lose more? Because it's not of who do I want to win. For an Auburn fan, it's like when Georgia and Alabama continue, for some reason, to play each other in the SEC championship game. You can't cheer for anybody. Strike two on Allred. So Gavin is now behind in the count.
I beg to differ on that, but that's...
Well, because you're a Georgia fan.
Yes.
I am not. 1-2 the count. Pitch on the way. That one misses. Ball two. So Allred stays alive.
Well, I know I'll never convert you.
No.
You're an Auburn fan through and through, and I respect that about you.
I enjoy being disappointed in life too much to convert. Allred stepping out, and he's going to put an elbow pad on. If you will remember, he took a pitch off of that elbow back against Heritage.
Oh, yes.
And he would stay in the game, but it was ugly.
Oh, he was not feeling good after that.
No, so 2-2 on the way, and he's going to hit that one to the right side. The first baseman, Scruggs, will field it and tag first by himself to get the first out of the inning. Good play over there by Scruggs, and so that will bring up for the Dogs Jack Roper. Roper batting in the number 9 spot. That's kind of his normal spot in the order. We've seen him down in that position pretty much all season long, so he will come to the plate. He is 0-for-1 on the night. And he comes to the plate with nobody on and one out. First pitch on the way from Ramsey. Breaking ball hit to the left side and foul.
Ramsey with 43 pitches, 30 strikes. Not bad.
Not at all.
Just that one bad inning in the third.
Roper fouls that one off, this time to the right side. So Jack in the hole, 0-2. Last week, the news came out of the controversy surrounding the Dodgers superstar Shohei Ohtani and his interpreter. And since then, I've heard a lot of water cooler talk. 0-2 on the way, and that one is fouled off at the plate, and he will stay alive. I have heard through the truths of social media, which we know means that we could lay our hand on the Bible.
It's gospel.
Yes.
Yeah.
First the 0-2, and that one is hit to the left side. It's going to be Collins who will charge in from the shortstop position. Fire on to first and not in time. Roper beats it out.
He waited too long to throw. He double clutched, and when he did that, that's all Roper needed to beat it out.
Jack hustling down the line, and he will stand at first base with one out, and we'll go back to the top of the order in X Holiday, who has had the hot bat. But I have heard, and of course this is all speculation I think at this point, that bets were placed.
Not Mookie Betts, but
not
bets.
Mookie Betts, but bets were placed in Shohei's hometown in Japan through that particular betting agency in games that Ohtani was pitching in or playing in. One of those happened to be a game against the Braves, in which the bet that was placed was on the over-under for the Braves, and that bet was won. Pitch on the way, and a check swing down to the first base side. The first baseman will tag first and fire on to second, and he is safe at second base is Jack Roper.
Yeah, because it's not a force when they tag the bag at first. He had to lay down the tag, and he slid under it.
And so Roper will be in safely, but X is retired over at first base for the second out, and that will bring up Ace Allen. There was also speculation that a bet was also placed in a game that Shohei was the starting pitcher against the Padres as Ramsey tries to keep or get Roper sleeping out there on second, fires back to the second base side, but Jack easily back safely. So I'm wondering just how deep this thing is. Roper is going to take off for third. The pitch is in the dirt. And Jack will be there safely with no throw down to third. Well, and Roper now 90 feet away.
And here's my opinion on that. You know, I don't know, but Shohei Ohtani is such a valuable asset to Major League Baseball. They're going to do everything they can to sweep as much as they can under the rug to keep him in. But if they do that, first the 1-0 pitch.
That's going to be another run.
Yep.
The good running by base running there by Jack Roper pays off as he comes in to tag home plate and give the Dogs another insurance run. And it's a 3-run lead. 4-1 is your score. And an RBI picked up once again by Ace Allen. Let's just say this. Shohei Ohtani is no Pete Rose. He is an asset to MLB right now. He's got the biggest contract in MLB.
See, Pete Rose was retired already.
Yep.
He was, he was managing only at that point,
right,
when he was suspended. But the fact that he was suspended for life from Major League Baseball, but then you'll suspend for life the 1919 Black Sox, but you won't suspend the 2017 Houston Astros for cheating like they did.
Pitch on the way to Tony Ware is fouled down the third base side.
So there's an obvious double standard
in MLB. And you've got a player who is still actively playing for the Houston Astros that was a part of that cheating scandal in Jose Altuve.
Yep.
And has been, not only is he still playing, but he is still a big part of that Astros organization.
Charlie Morton was too, but, you know, and Brian McCann.
We're not going to talk about those guys. We're going to talk about Altuve because we don't like Altuve. We like the other guys. But I agree, it's a total double standard. It's such an unfortunate situation, and I agree with you. MLB is going to do everything that they can as we're caught in another rundown, and again, he's going to be in safely. The throw gets away. He's going to go to third, and he's in safely at third. The throw is going to get away, but he's going to hold there. Ace Allen.
I'll tell you what, though, if he had gone to home plate, he probably would have scored.
I think that young man went to Walmart and got a pair of those light-up tennis shoes with the Velcro on them and said, look how fast I can run.
Yeah, that's great. First to third on that play.
My goodness. He can't be stopped. Ace Allen over at third base. Tony Ware at the plate. That just misses.
Well, and also, and I'll get off my stay off my long bit here in a second, but
no, I like it. I'm all about it.
But not just Major League Baseball, but just about every professional sport. First, the 1-1 pitch, strike two called. Yeah, they're emphasizing betting on the game.
They are. You're right.
It has become part of the culture of the game, and that's so unfortunate because, you know, it's a destructive habit for a lot of people, including professional athletes. That misses outside 2-2. But I mean, look at people who athletes who've gotten involved with that kind of thing. Calvin Ridley comes to mind for it, the Falcons.
Yep.
I mean, and then allegedly Shohei Ohtani with the Dodgers. So I mean, it's crazy how that's kind of gone for professional sports.
2-2 pitch hit down the third base side. It'll be Hickson who will fire on to first and in time for out number three. But the Dogs strike for one more. They have a 3-run lead as we go to the top of the fifth inning. You're listening to Cedartown High School Baseball here on the Cedartown Bulldog Sports Network. We'll be back after this quick word from our sponsors.
Coverage of Cedartown High School Bulldogs baseball on the Big Double A is brought to you in part by Republican State Representative Trey Kelly of Cedartown.
This is Representative Trey Kelly. I want to wish all the players and coaches a safe and successful season. You've worked hard to represent us on the field, and I'm proud to represent you in the Georgia House of Representatives. Again, this is Representative Trey Kelly, and I want to thank you for listening to the Big Double A. Go Dogs!
This announcement paid for by State Representative Trey Kelly, KellyForHouse.com. Cedar Stream, the industry leader in screen-printed apparel. They offer screen printing, embroidery, and signs and banners. At Cedar Stream, they have a fully automated screen printing facility here in Cedartown with the ability to efficiently and effectively distribute products all over the United States. Cedar Stream is a local family-run business with a big vision. Contact Cedar Stream today to find out what they can do for you. 800-686-7488 or cedarstream.com. Cedar Stream. Shirts. It's what we do.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Bulldogs lead 4-1 on 9 hits. Kind of opposite from the previous game. Dogs only had a couple hits until the sixth inning. One run on one hit and two errors for the Northwest Bruins as we are underway here into the fifth inning. Cedartown looking to sweep these Bruins out of town, and they got a good chance to do it here. Still lots of baseball left to be played. But here we go with the top of the fifth inning leading it off. Will be Deacon Edwards, the catcher.
First pitch on the way from Jay O'Neill. That one's in the dirt. O'Neill had a 1-2-3 inning. They appeal down to the first base umpire, and they say, no, he did not go.
It was close, though.
So Edwards heading the count 1-0. O'Neill looks in, gets the sign from Allred, and the pitch is on the way. That one is taken upstairs, ball two, but O'Neill fired a heck of a top of the fourth inning. Retired the Bruins in order. Swing and a miss, a big cut there by the catcher.
Well, he was way late on that one, I'm telling you.
Two balls, one strike to count. O'Neill working quickly. The pitch is on the way, and that one's going to be lifted out of play. And the count is now even at two balls and two strikes. Again, the Dogs, a little bit of time off coming up. They will not be back in action until Thursday, and that'll be from Lake Point. And then on Friday, they'll have a doubleheader. Pitch on the way, and that one is chopped to the shortstop. It'll be X Holiday who bobbles it but picks it up, fires on to first, and
yes,
he is in time for the out. What a recovery there by X. He fires over to third, and once again, Cole Dingler making a heck of a play at first base to get the Dogs an out, and that'll be the first out of the inning.
He picks those balls just as good as anybody over there at first base, and a great job there. You just talk about how good first baseman and how valuable they are to the game of baseball. I mean, look at the Braves when they had Freddie Freeman and now Olsen, and here a great job there by Dingler, who has been done a great job. That first pitch misses, ball one to Harrison, but wow, what a great play.
Pitch on the way from O'Neill, and that one is sky to the right side. It'll be Caleb Formby who will drift out into the grass and will make the grab for out number two. So two up, two down here in the top of the fifth inning. I was talking with my boss today at work, my other boss at my other work, about Olsen, and we were talking about, you know, just how almost mirror images Matt Olsen and Freddie Freeman are in so many ways. Big, tall, lanky guys, play really good defense, and they hit the ball and are just doubles machines. Olsen had a double in today's win over the Phillies, and it's amazing to compare those two guys.
First pitch missed, one ball, no strikes to Cooley.
Hit back up the middle. Oh, it's going to get through the hole there, and it's going to be fired over to first, but not in time. Went right between O'Neill's legs. Couldn't make a play, but X Holiday charged in from shortstop, tried to clean
it
up.
Close.
Made it close, but Cooley will reach with a two-out single, and that will bring up Spates, the second baseman.
Well, they're both left-handed batters.
They are.
They're both sluggers. I mean, they're just really,
and
really good.
Throw over to first, and oh, that was close, but
very
he is
close.
Back by the hair of his chinny chin chin.
Very close, very close.
O'Neill comes set. Pitch on the way. That one is well inside. That one might have stained his uniform a little bit. I mean, he's not going to win that argument, but if I were him, I'd be making the same argument. It ruffled his feathers. I'll put it that way. One ball, no strikes to count on Spates.
I'm sure he heard it coming.
And the throw back over to first. And again, oh, this one gets past Dingler. And so Cooley is going to go to second, and he will hold there.
That is the first error of this ball game for the Bulldogs.
Return.
But honestly, I think, you know, I hated to lose Freddie Freeman because of what he meant to the organization. But Matt Olson has filled that spot well.
Well,
he's in his third season.
He has.
And he's a hometown boy.
And I will be honest.
And Freeman's back home in California where he grew up. And so is Matt Olson back home in Georgia.
First the pitch, and that one is foul back. I'll be honest. I'm not happy that he left. Not happy with him. I understand everything about the situation that we know as true can be. First the 1-1 from O'Neill. That one's in the dirt ball too.
Well, isn't his agent Scott Boras?
I don't know. I know that there were rumors that came out that his agent did not communicate certain aspects of a deal that the Braves had proposed.
And I think that was never really confirmed. But
it was not. I think that was a lot of hope and wish and prayer and a lot of Braves fans that wanted to believe better of Freddie Freeman. But here's my
– I think the radio host that actually broke that news got sued.
Probably so.
For reporting something that wasn't true. And then I think he eventually retracted his statement. But still, I mean, there was a lot of – stuff behind that. There's a strike called.
That'll make the count full at 3 balls and 2 strikes. Here's the deal, though. I feel the same way about Freddie Freeman that I felt about Brian McCann when he left and went to the Yankees. When McCann left and went to the Yankees, I hoped that he was going to blow out both of his knees.
Oof.
But O'Neill surrenders a 2-out walk. But after I got past the first few years of not having McCann, I forgave him for all of his sins. I welcomed him back into the loving arms of the Braves country. And he is now, as he was when he was in Atlanta, one of my all-time favorite Braves players. Freddie Freeman will be the exact same. Now, on the other hand, Dansby Swanson can kick rocks. Runners at first and second, 2 out. O'Neill fires and delivers. That one's in the dirt. It's going to get away from Allred. The runner from second will move up to third to throw down. Not in time. It was close, but Cooley gets in there safely. So the Bruins now with the runner at first and third, and Scruggs at the plate.
Well, that was that was pretty brutal about McCann. The thing about McCann when he left, though, it really wasn't McCann. It was the Braves front office at the time.
I don't care. Okay. I was a firm member of McCann's cans. I mean, I had a membership card and everything. That one is lifted to the right side. It's going to be a play for Cole Dingler. A chance to get the Dogs out of the innings, and he makes the catch. And the Bruins will strand 2. We go to the bottom of the 5th. 4-1 your score. The Dogs are on top by 3. We'll be back after this break here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Hey, it's the Border Mexican Restaurant, located at 718 North Main Street right here in Cedartown. Their phone number, 678-246-1031. They serve a wide variety of your favorite Mexican food made fresh daily. Great food, great fun. It's great for the whole family. Come see us at the Border Restaurant right here on Main Street in Cedartown. Or you can call for takeout at 678-246-1031. The Border Mexican Restaurant is the best Mexican food north of the border. That's the Border Restaurant right here in Cedartown.
Bradford's Drug Store on North Main Street in Cedartown is your locally owned and operated Good Neighbor Pharmacy. Bradford's accepts most prescription plans, and remember Bradford's for all of your gift and decor needs. Bradford's pharmacist takes time to get to know you, explain your medication, and answer any questions that you may have. Go by and see Bill Brewster and all the fine folks at Bradford's the next time you need a prescription filled. Also use their convenient drive-thru. Bradford's Drug Store, 500 North Main Street, Cedartown, 770-748-3100. And all the folks at Bradford's say, go Dogs.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Cedartown Bulldog Baseball here on the Cedartown Bulldog Sports Network, 106.1 FM, AM 1340. And, of course, we're streaming on our social media platforms, Facebook Live, YouTube, and the NFHS Network on the Cedartown Bulldog Sports Network. 4 runs, 9 hits, 1 error for the Bulldogs. 1 run, 2 hits, and 2 errors for the Northwest Bruins. And that song means Samuel Formby is about to come to the plate. He'll lead it off here in the bottom half of the fifth inning?
Yes, we are. home half of the fifth, Formby will come to the plate.
On the home stretch.
It'll be 4, 5, and 6 due up for the Dogs. First pitch on the way from Ramsey. Breaking ball misses upstairs. Ball one.
Well, I'll tell you what, another great homemade meal down below us. That they had some, first the 1-0.
Drilled to the right side, and that's going to be down again. Bobbles it over in right field, but he's going to be able to corral it, and Formby will be at first with a leadoff single to start the home half of the fifth. Dogs looking to add some more insurance runs. They already lead by 3-4-1, but I tell you what, I'd love for him to pour it on and pick up a couple of more.
Here's Tweet.
Tweet.
Owen Gerald will bat here. What I was saying was they had homemade barbecue sandwiches from the crock pot. They also had, I think they had chicken spaghetti, too.
They had chicken spaghetti. They had red velvet cake with and without pecans. I had with. You had without. They also had a strawberry punch bowl that sounded delicious. Pitch on the way, and that one misses. Ball one.
I think they had coconut cake, too.
They did. They had coconut cake as well. All kinds of good homemade.
If you love dinner, if you love dinner on the grounds at church, you will love the fair here at the ballpark.
And we're in another rundown. Formby down to second, and this time it will be in time.
I hope he's not hurt.
And he went into second base. Weird, but he pops up and he'll be okay.
That was scary.
That was. He slid into second very awkwardly.
Well, and I think the second baseman had the bag blocked.
That one's in there for a called strike one against Gerald, which apparently is a new rule in MLB this year.
Cannot block the
bag. You cannot block
the bag.
The bag. 1-1 the count. Pitch on the way. That one's outside ball two. Now, how, why, who, what, when, and where? 1-1 the count, sorry. Pitch on the way. That one's in there called strike two.
So no more slide. You know, I remember back in the day, you would slide to take out a double play.
Yep, you'd take them out.
And then here's the 1-2.
That one's hit to the right side. It's going to be Spates. He will come in from second. Fire over to first to Scruggs for the out. So that will be the second out of the inning. And it will bring up the first baseman, Cole Dingler.
And those epic collisions at the plate.
The turning of the shortstop or the second baseman, whoever was covering second on the play, as the guy was sliding in, just upending them.
Yeah.
I mean, just some acrobatic feats of,
it is,
I don't know.
It is no more.
It is no more. Baseball, as we know, it is done. At some point, they're going to not let us chew sunflower seeds. I don't know. Dingler, though, tattoos that one to the left side, but the center fielder will come in and make a play, and that will be it for the Dogs. We will go to the top of the sixth inning. Cedartown with a 3-run lead. It is 4-1 here at the Dog Pound. Friday Night Baseball here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network. We'll be back after a word from our sponsors.
Cedar Valley Golf Course has been the place to play golf in Cedartown and Polk County for nearly a century. Locally owned and operated since 1924, Cedar Valley Golf Course offers 18 holes of some of the most beautiful fairways and greens in the area. Cedar Valley Golf Course is a proud supporter of the Cedartown High School Bulldogs and the greater Cedartown and Polk County region. Call for tee time, 770-748-9671, located just south of Cedartown at 1811 Buchanan Highway. Cedartown's original golf course, Cedar Valley Golf Course.
Cedartown Automotive is your one stop for all your automotive needs. For oil changes, new tires, or tire repair, brake work, tune-ups, air conditioner service, or repair, think of Cedartown Automotive. Cedartown Automotive is a longtime supporter of Cedartown High School Athletics here on WGAA. Cedartown Automotive on East Avenue in Cedartown. Give them a call today at 770-749-5040 or stop by their beautiful location for fast and friendly service. And all the folks at Cedartown Automotive say, go Dogs!
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Well, we're back here, top of the sixth inning. Very quick bottom half of the fifth after the runner was picked off at second base. Dogs lead a score of 4-1 as we head to the sixth inning. Looks like it'll be numero 6 to lead things off for the Bruins here. Still facing number 10 for the Bulldogs. Jay O'Neill will begin his third inning of work. He looked really good, Sam, in that previous inning. And but two innings has kind of been his limit to where he's been able to control. So if he can get past another inning here, maybe even the next inning, then I think that'll be a great step up for him in his recovery process from his surgery.
I agree. I think that this inning is going to be very critical for him. If he can have another quick 1-2-3 inning, you might see him in the seventh. But then again, Coach Johnson might say, you know what, you gave me three solid innings, that's enough. Pull him and put somebody else in there. You saw Ra Ware would come in and close things out for the Dawgs in game one of this doubleheader.
O'Neill with 32 pitches already.
First pitch on the way from O'Neill. Here comes number 33, and it's hit back right to him. He will field and take it over to first for out number one. So one pitch, one out for the Dawgs here in the top of the sixth inning. O'Neill still looking sharp. It'll bring up Gavin Knuckles.
I like it, I like it.
The right fielder for the Bruins.
I'd love it. Three-pitch inning.
O'Neill comes set, pitch on the way. It's going to be at least four. That one's in there, called strike one. Jay comes set, pitch on the way. Swing and a miss, strike two. I tell you what, he's also working quickly. He's already getting ready for that college pitch clock. Not wasting any time. The pause, the delivery, that one's upstairs. You see him do that every now and then. He will either make a pause or he'll almost make a double kick.
You know, if I did that, I'd probably fall over.
I couldn't do it.
I'd fall over.
I couldn't do it in general. That one's fouled off the right side.
Of course, I can't throw 89 miles an hour, which is what I think O'Neill would like to get back up to toward the end of the season. I think he's throwing in the maybe low to mid-80s right now. But he would love to top that velocity off here as he works his way back.
And well, and as you said earlier with the control, that's something that's going to come back. You know,
right.
You don't have to worry about that, really. We know that that's going to come back as that one is fouled, and Knuckles will stay alive. One ball, two strikes, still the count as he's fouled off the last two pitches. The control will come back. The velocity will come back. The stamina will come back. Everything will start to come back as O'Neill progresses in his rehab. 1-2 the count. Pitch on the way. Just missed. Ball two. Two balls, two strikes. Nobody on, one out. Top of the sixth inning. 2-2 on the way. That one is fouled off. And Knuckles putting up a good battle here against the Bulldogs reliever in Jay O'Neill. O'Neill in his third inning of work. Cole Cochran would go three innings. He gave up one run, one hit. Recorded three strikeouts and walked two as that one gets away from Allred. It was in the dirt outside, so ball three now the count. And it is a full count on Knuckles. Gavin is 0 for 1 with a strikeout and a walk. Payoff pitch on the way. Inside, lost him. Ball four. So Knuckles draws the one-out walk, and that will bring up Hickson. Third baseman who is 0 for 1 with a walk and a strikeout. O'Neill comes set, pitch on the way. That one is going to get away from Allred in the dirt. And so Knuckles will move up to second base, and Hickson is ahead in the count. 1-0. Now you have to wonder how much of a leash does Coach Johnson give O'Neill here?
Well, and I think Coach Johnson will be the first to tell you that the last time he had O'Neill in a spot like this, he left him out there too long.
Pitch on the way. That one misses.
Oh, that looked like a pretty good pitch to me. Maybe a little bit low, 2-0 the count. But, yeah, I think he's going to be pretty cautious with how long he keeps him in. I think if he loses the batter here, you might see him pop out. He's already kind of walking around the dugout.
Pitch on the way, swing and a miss.
But you come back with a pitch like that, kind of makes you feel a little bit better.
So count now 2-1 on Hickson. First for the pitch now, and it's hit to the right side. It's going to be a play for Formby. He's over, makes the grab. No, he lost it. And that one's going to get down and go all the way to the wall. The throw in, it's going to go to X Holiday on the infield, and the run from second is going to score. And it's now 4-2.
Rare mistake there in right field there by Samuel Formby. He's almost automatic out there, and wow, that's a huge mistake there. A huge error over there in right. It'll be scored as an E9, and the run will come home to score from second. Bank Knuckles touches the plate, and it's a 4-2 ball game. Tying run will come to the plate here. But that is not that was not his O'Neill's fault. O'Neill had a good pitch there, and it should have been called.
Has a good pitch there to start off. Crossing with a called strike one. Sam is 0-2 with a strikeout. O'Neill looks in, and the pitch is on the way. That one misses ball one. One ball, one strike. Now the count on the Bruins DH. Hickson stands out at second base. 4-2 is your score. One run already across, one out, one on. Pitch on the way. That one's outside, ball two. If he doesn't get this one, do we see a visit?
Would not shock me at all. At least a visit from the pitching coach, Coach Smith.
2-1 the count. O'Neill fires. Comes back with a good pitch on the outside part of the plate. Gets a call strike two. Two balls, two strikes the count. On crossing. O'Neill trying to battle here. He wants to leave that runner at second exactly where he is. 2-2 the count, pitch on the way, and that one is chopped foul. So Crossan will stay alive. Top of the seventh in South Beach, the Pirates pouring it on the Marlins, 6-1.
Pirates might be pretty good this year.
The Astros still beating the Yankees, 1-0, bottom of the fourth. The Rays have capped things off against Toronto, 8-2. Pitch on the way, misses outside. Three balls, two strikes.
Is that
full
game
count
at Houston?
Yes, it is in Houston.
So I wish that the roof would be stuck open and it would rain.
Yeah.
That would be wonderful. That
it would.
That's the only outcome I would like for that game at all.
3-2 the count. Payoff pitch on the way. That one is fouled back, and Crossan stays alive against O'Neill.
And you may disagree with me on this. I wasn't glad that Houston won the World Series in 22.
But
I was happy that Dusty Baker got a World Series.
I was too.
He finally got one after all those years.
Full count. Payoff pitch again on the way. That one misses. Ball four, and Crossan will jog down to first base, and the Bruins have runners at first and second. And it looks like at least Allred is going to go out and talk to O'Neill.
Ace Allen also over there to talk to him. But that was the only reason, yep, I was happy to see.
Dusty Baker, one of the best guys to ever come through Major League Baseball.
He,
as a player, as a coach, as a manager, He did it all, and you're right. He absolutely deserved it.
Well, his first year managing, he managed a 102-win Giants team in, yep, 93 that just missed the playoffs because the Braves had one more win.
Right.
Back in the old days of the
Braves
Eastern
playing
and Western,
yep,
divisions.
Yep. But that'll bring up Edwards. He comes to the plate with runners at first and second. But other than that, that's the only reason why we were happy about that.
Of course, he was with the Cubs for a while, came up short with them.
That one's fouled off third base side, so Edwards behind in the count.
I think he also coached the Nationals for a little while.
He did.
And then came out of retirement to take the job after everything fell apart in the Houston cheating scandal. But I think he was the only man who could have taken that job, in my opinion.
0-1 the count against Edwards. O'Neill, long look into Allred, and the pitch is on the way. And that one's hit up the middle, and it's going to be played on a hop. They'll go to second for the out, and now to first. And that's the double play. A 4-6-3 will do it in the top of the sixth inning. The Bruins strike for one, but they leave two. 4-2 is your score. We'll go to the home half of the sixth. We'll be back after a word from our sponsors here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Looking for a good used vehicle?
Don't go out of town. Come see the folks at Dingler Motor Company, 526 North Main Street. Bad credit, no credit, no problem. Dingler Motor Company can get you back on the road in no time with their in-house financing. Top quality pre-owned late model cars, trucks, and SUVs. Stop by and check out their wide selection at 526 North Main Street across from Live Wire Surplus. Call them at 770-748-0906. Search them on Facebook at Dingler Motor Co. That's Dingler Motor Company.
Rocky and Patty Tillery, two Cedartown High School graduates, and they stayed right here in the county and went into business. They employ right at 100 people, and they've been doing that for a long time. Most of their work is from out of the county, but they want to push our youngsters here, no matter what they're doing, Little League, Pony League, high school baseball, basketball, football, and soccer. And that's Polk County Public Service. They appreciate serving you.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Four two, the score. Cedartown leads as we head to the bottom half of the sixth. He's Sam Branch. I'm Andrew Carter here from the Dog Pound. Dogs have taken two of three already and trying to take three of three, but the Bruins scored their first run since the third inning in the top of this inning. But the last time that happened in the sixth inning, the Dogs had a nine-run inning. So maybe the Dogs can do that here in this one and put some distance between them.
We would love to see it. Throw down to second from Edwards, and we should be ready to go with Caleb Formby. You know, going off of what we were talking about last half inning, you mentioned that Dusty Baker came out of retirement to coach that team and took him to a World Series. Bruce Bochy,
yeah,
did the same exact thing. Coached in San Francisco.
Yep.
Retired. Came out of retirement, went to coach the Rangers, and won a World Series with him.
I love it.
First pitch on the way to Formby, and that one's fouled off, and so it's 0-1.
If you think about it, Brian Snicker with the Braves in 21, and then Dusty Baker 22, yep, and then Bochy Bruce, in 23. Yep. Talk about the oldest managers to ever win a World Series right there.
Yep.
I mean,
they're up there.
They're up there. Last three World Series.
Pitch on the way to Formby, misses ball one. So the count, one ball, one strike. The count on the Bulldogs' second baseman and Caleb Formby.
I'd love to have some insurance runs.
I would, too. That one misses ball two. Formby is 0 for 1. Ramsey comes set, and the pitch is on the way. That one...
Wow.
It's a strike. Two balls, two strikes to count on for me. I was going to say, I guess it caught the corner, the outside corner of the plate, but
it didn't.
It didn't. 2-2 the count, and that one is well inside, ball three. So the count now full on the Bulldogs leadoff man in Caleb Formby. 4-2 is your score. Dogs on top, leading the Bruins. Pitch on the way. That one is fouled off to the right side. Cedartown would score one in the bottom of the first, two in the bottom of the third after the Bruins scored one in the top of the third. Then Cedartown would come back in the bottom of the fourth to pick up another run, and Northwest scoring a solo run in the top of the sixth. And Formby is on with a leadoff walk.
Borderline caught pitch right there, but good eye there.
Well, there was another borderline pitch earlier, so we might have gotten that one back. But either way you cut it, Formby is down at first base, and that will bring up Gavin Allred. The Bulldogs' backstop is 0 for 1 with a walk.
Yeah, but his last at bat, he drew that walk, and it was a great
really,
at-bat.
It was a really solid at bat, like you mentioned, for somebody that doesn't get to swing the stick that much. So throw over to first, and Formby is back safely.
Tell you what, they're aware of us on the base pads now. The only way they've been able to get any outs on steal attempts have been pickoff moves, not throws from home plate.
Pitch on the way. That one's upstairs. Throw down to first.
Close.
Formby is back. He kind of froze there. And Edwards, the Deacon, delivered a strike down to first base.
The Deacon almost deked him.
Yes, he did. But thankfully, Formby was back safely. Pitch on the way, and runner goes, swing and a miss, and that's going to be a strike, but the runner is down at second safely with no throw. And so Formby now at second base with another stolen bag. Speaking of Deacon, have you watched the ESPN special on Reggie White, the Minister of Defense?
I have not.
I have not either, but growing up, he was one of my all-time favorite football players. That one is hit to the right side. That one's going to get down. Are they going to wave him home? They will. The throw in, the play at the plate, he is safe. Formby coming around to score from second. Allred picks up the RBI single, and the Dogs extend it back out to a three-run lead. 5-2 is your score here in the bottom of the sixth inning.
Can you say insurance?
And that was exactly what we needed. Dogs able to put together another hit with runners on, and great job there by Allred to get that single and solidly hit too, and he'll be relieved for a courtesy runner. It'll be, I believe,
Brody Blackman
out there to run for him.
So it'll be the bottom of the order in Jack Roper, who is 1-for-2 with a run scored.
Roper's been swinging a good bat of late.
He has, and he was smart on the base pads too, and that led to that run that he scored. So he comes to the plate with a chance to add more as that one misses. Edwards popped up like he was going to throw down to first again, but mishandled it, and so Blackman now running for Allred is back in there safely at first with no throw. And Roper is ahead in the count, 1-ball, no strikes. But Reggie White was one of my favorites. I was a Packers fan back in the day when it was Reggie White and Brett Favre. They were just so good back in the 90s. My heart was broken the year, though, and I hate to say this, first the 1-0. And the pitch is on the way, and that one's fouled back. But it was the year that Michael Vick and the Atlanta Falcons went to Lambeau and beat them in the snow, and it was the first time that the Packers had lost a playoff game at Lambeau Field in like 40-something years. And I was devastated.
Oh,
I was not a Falcons fan growing up.
I was joyous.
1-1 pitch on the way, and that one is hit out to center field. It's going to be Cooley who will drift over, and he will make the squeeze for the out. And so Blackman goes back to first base as Roper flies out to Cooley for the first out of the inning. Back to the top of the order, and X Holiday, who has been hot tonight. 1-for-2, 2 runs scored. He was hit squarely in the back earlier in the game. And of course, as you can see, that has not affected him at all. So he comes to the plate with a runner on and one out. First pitch on the way from Ramsey. That one's chopped down to the first base side, but foul.
No, I was quite happy with when that happened. Of course, that season ended in disappointment, as has every Falcons season
every
in history.
Every single one. But, and I still can't.
But I'm still a Falcons fan.
And I still can't bring myself to say that I'm a diehard Falcons fan. Pitch on the way, and that one is hit up the middle. It's going to be Collins. He will field and go to second. No chance at the double play, so Blackman will be thrown out at second base as X will be over at first base with two outs, and it's going to bring up another hot bat with the hot shoes, Ace Allen. Allen, 3-for-3. An RBI and a run scored, and a couple of stolen bases to add to it. He'll face off against Ramsey for the fourth time tonight. Pitch on the way. Runner goes in X Holiday, and he is going to be safe. Collins mishandled the throw, but I think he was going to be safe anyways.
Yeah, I think he was. He got a great jump.
And he can move, buddy. X can motor. So Holiday down to second base. I believe the pitch was a ball.
I think it was, too. That's what I put on the board.
And it's we'll call it a ball. Pitch on the way from Ramsey, and that one is definitely a ball. So 2 balls, no strikes to count on Ace Allen. Ramsey checks the runner at second. Now looks into Edwards, and he'll step off, getting X to retreat back to second base. It's hard for me to say that I'm a fan of any NFL team, honestly. I pull for the Falcons. I want the Falcons to win. Runner goes, and that one is lifted to the right side, and it is going to go foul out of play. So Allen will have to come back, and Holiday will have to come back. Of course, my boys like to cheer for the Cowboys because their mom is a native of Dallas.
Poor kids.
They enjoy being disappointed just as much as I do. I guess that's one thing that's rubbed off. 3-1 count, pitch is on the way. That one's hit right back up the middle, and Allen is going to be aboard. X is going to round third, and he will be in there home safe. And it is a 4-run lead for the Dogs, 6-2, as Ace Allen continues his perfect night. Now 4-for-4, 2 RBIs.
Talk about a turnaround from game one. Went 0-for-4 in the first game.
And now
is today.
Yep.
Now perfect 4-for-4.
So that's going to bring up Tony Ware. He'll try to keep the inning going. He's 1-for-3 with 2 RBIs. I like Josh Allen. I like the way that he plays, so I like to cheer for the Bills. Also, I kind of like to cheer for the Bills because they're kind of that underdog team that still just they can't quite get over the hump as Tony Ware looks at a called strike one.
Well, you know, everybody was starting to call the Atlanta Braves the Buffalo Bills of baseball in the 90s when they were going to these World Series and they could never close the deal. Finally did in 95 and then, of course, in 2021.
Oh, one pitch is in there for called strike two, so Tony behind in the count. But the Bills went to something like, what, 4 Super Bowls in a row and couldn't win one? Talk about misery.
Yeah.
My goodness.
Plus, it's cold up there.
Yeah, it is. I mean, that streak makes Kathy Bates look like an angel.
Well, you know, I'll never forget. First, the 0-2 pitch.
And that is hit up the middle, and Tony Ware is going to deliver. Allen is going to round second. He's going to go into third, and he's going to hold there. The throw comes into second base, and the Dogs will have runners at the corners thanks to Tony Ware keeping the inning alive, and that'll bring up Samuel Formby, who is 2-for-3.
That's hit number 13 for the Bulldogs in this ball game.
The hit parade just keeps on going.
Bulldogs, number 6, Samuel Formby.
You remember that playoff game this past season? Where Patrick Mahomes' helmet actually broke because it was so cold.
Yes. Yes, I did.
That was in Kansas. That was in Kansas City, I believe.
It was the playoff game. Yeah. And that one is inside. Ball one.
Coldest game I think ever.
Yep, it beat the Ice Bowl between Green Bay and Dallas. It was played up at Lambeau Field. That one's hit to the right side. That one's going to be through. 7-2 is your score.
Another big sixth inning for the Bulldogs.
It's 7-2. The Dogs leading here in the bottom of the sixth.
Ladies and gentlemen, this team.
Something happened.
This team is playing with some authority, with some conviction right now. They came in and they shocked everybody and beat them 11-2 on Monday, a team in Northwest Whitfield that only lost 2 games all season and was 6-0 in region play. The Dogs are playing great right now, and that one pops away. Runners move up. And
going to be a play at the plate. Safe.
He came
Tony
all the way
Ware.
Around from.
He was on the move already from second to third when the pitch got away from Edwards. They gave him the green light, and it is a 4-run inning and a 6-run lead. Here in the bottom of the sixth, it is 8-2 at the dog pound.
Incredible. My goodness.
What a game so far for these Dogs. Owen Gerald is the batter, by the way, and he hits that one to the center fielder. It's going to be Cooley who will drift over, and he's going to make the play finally for out number 3. But the Bruins give up 4. The Dogs take a 6-run lead into the top of the 7th. It's Cedartown High School Friday Night Baseball here on the Big Double A. We'll be back after a word from our sponsors here on the Cedartown Bulldogs Sports Network.
Are you ready for steel? Equipment, that is. At Croker's Hardware in Cedartown, we've got all the steel equipment. Blowers and shredder vacs, chainsaws, augers and drills, trimmers and brush cutters. We're very proud to be a retailer for the steel product line. As an independent dealer, we can provide many services that the big box chain stores just can't match. Our friendly and knowledgeable staff is always ready to help you select the equipment that meets your specific needs. So call Croker's for a steel today. That's 770-748-4842 to learn more about steel in Cedartown.
Timeout.
All right. Remember, we're a team that plays together. Listen, the winning will take care of itself. We just have to get everyone involved.
In interscholastic sports, we celebrate what makes every one of us unique. And in the pursuit of a common goal, everyone in the huddle, in the bleachers, and in the community comes together. This message presented by the GHSA and the Georgia Athletic Directors Association.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Top of the seventh we go. Cedartown 8-2, a four spot in the bottom half of the sixth. Something about the sixth inning. And Cedartown is just firing on all cylinders right now. Back out there to pitch again. No, who is out there now?
That is
Sam?
Pilgrim.
Yeah. Owen Pilgrim, he will take to the mound after Jay O'Neill goes three innings, one hit, one run. It was unearned, three walks and two strikeouts. So not bad for O'Neill.
No, but I also like the decision to go ahead and pull him.
Yeah, me too.
I think you saw him start to wear there in the sixth, and I think that's a good decision there by Coach
Johnson to give
this one over to Pilgrim.
His appearances, they're going to ease him back into it, kind of like you do with pitchers in spring training. Because you'll never see a pitcher start their first game of spring training and go nine innings.
Well, and
here's They'll go two and a half, three innings.
And here's the thing, too, with turning this one over to Pilgrim. You're not handing a 16-year-old the keys to the Camaro and saying, eh, maybe he'll get it home safely. Pilgrim has proved himself throughout this season. He came in a tough spot earlier in the season and pitched a gem of a game when X Holiday got injured. He has cemented himself as a big-time reliever for the Dogs, and that's who I like to see out there right now in this situation. So he comes up, and he will face the Bruins in their last chance here in the top of the seventh. Pitch on the way, and that's hit to the left side. It's going to be X Holiday from the shortstop position to fire over, and it is going to be safe as the throw pulled Dingler off of the bag. So the Bruins will lead things off with a single. Purdue has defeated Gonzaga to move on to the Elite Eight by a final score of 80-68, and NC State continues their run in the tournament. They knock off number two Marquette 67-58 to move on. Duke and Houston, they're a little over 10 minutes away from getting started. Sweet 16 action, but we'll get back to the game here called strike one from Pilgrim.
To Cooley.
Cooley, top of the order. One on, nobody out. Pitch on the way. Just missed. Ball one.
Cooley today is 2-for-3, a run scored.
One, one, the count. Pitch on the way. That one is in the dirt. Two balls, one strike. Good stop there by Allred. The Dogs with a six-run lead trying to complete the series sweep. That one misses, and the throw down to first from Allred. Get past Dingler, but the runner does not move up. Formby there over in right field backing it up and quickly getting it back in.
Boy, I'll tell you what, we dodged a bullet right there. There's no doubt about it.
So 3-1 the count.
By the way, after today's game, Cedartown will not be back home again until April the 9th when we host Southeast Whitfield. We go there to Southeast for a doubleheader. And we've only got two more home games left.
Pitch on the way from Pilgrims upstairs, ball four.
So first and second now with nobody out.
Not the way you want to get things started. And so it looks like Ace Allen and Cole Dingler are both going to come in, talk to Pilgrim, get him to settle back in, and see if we can't get ourselves a sweep. As Marty Huggins would say in the campaign, get your brooms, because it's a mess. One of the best movies I think I've ever seen. Pitch on the way. Strike one.
You know, I saw The Rookie for the first time in a long time the other day. It was one of the free movies on YouTube.
Yeah.
And I watched it again, Disney's The Rookie, with Quaid.
Yep.
Great movie.
That one is skied backwards, and it will reach the stands just behind the bleachers. A long strike two on Spates. first baseman.
Based on a true story.
What is your favorite baseball movie of all time?
Field of Dreams.
Gotta be. Gotta be.
Major League is also pretty good.
It's pretty good. Angels in the Outfield.
Oh, yeah.
That one is lifted to the shortstop, and it will be X Holiday and the umpire. X Holiday and Ace Allen all collided. The ball was dropped.
Now, infield fly was called, right?
I don't know, because Spates has come back, and the count's still 0-2. Did he call interference on himself?
I guess he did.
0-2, pitch on the way. In the dirt. Ball one, good stop there by Allred. And I think Angels in the Outfield, just because that was, you know, right in the midst of my childhood.
I tried to find that movie. It's not out anywhere. It's not on Disney Plus.
Swing and a miss. That should be strike three.
Shouldn't it be?
Three. Did we restart the count? I don't know. Pitch on the way from Pilgrim. That's a swing and a miss. I think we restarted the count. Now it's 0-2.
Okay. Strike four.
One ball, strike two. Five. Actually, it's one ball, two strikes, according to the umpire. So one ball, strikes, two on, nobody out.
I'm very confused.
Pitch on the way. Ooh. That one had a lot of break to it from Pilgrim, and it hung up inside 2-2. When he let that one loose, it looked like it was going to hit Scruggs from my viewpoint. It is almost 10 o'clock, so it's, you know, I'm starting to wane a little bit. But that one is lifted to the right side, but foul, out of play. And so Scruggs stays alive. Two on, nobody out, 2-2 the count. The Dogs lead by 6. 8-2 is your score.
Is there nobody out?
There is nobody out.
Game Changer has one out.
Did they call him out then? That one is tattooed, and X Holiday with a play. The step on the back, and I think that's the ball game.
Yes, it is.
It is. They called him out at the play there with the umpire. That's a double play. That's your ball game. That is a series sweep in the region against the Northwest Whitfield Bruins. The Dogs picking up the win here at home, 8-2. Let's take a 60-second break, and we'll come back and wrap this one up. You're listening to Cedartown High School Friday Night
right
Baseball.
Play. Go to Peach State Ford in Cedartown today.
Rush to Peach State Ford in Cedartown. Peach State Ford has a championship lineup of new and pre-owned vehicles. Peach State Ford is now open in your backyard.
Peach State Ford is proud to be part of your local community. Whether you're waiting for your vehicle to get serviced, picking up a part for your vehicle, or stopping by to check out a new vehicle for yourself, Peach State Ford offers a wide range of amenities to enhance your experience. Peach State Ford in Cedartown, 2076 Rockmart Highway, 770-748-3673.
Live Wire Surplus. Stop in today at 546 North Main Street. New items are arriving all the time. At LiveWire, they have unbelievable deals on lawnmowers, weed eaters, and leaf blowers. But that's not all. How about your patio? LiveWire has top-of-the-line grills, patio tables and chairs, fire pits, and so much more. All fresh off the truck, brand new, still packaged, and priced to sell. LiveWire Surplus, 678-861-5021. Take your truck. You're going to need it to load up on the savings.
Cedartown High School Baseball is on the Big Double A.
Cedartown wins by a score of 8-2. Dogs improve their region record to what, 4-4 now? Yeah, so 4-4. And South and Northwest Whitfield falls to 6-3 in region action as the Bulldogs take care of business. Taking care of business, TCB, a little bit TCB. The final line on this one, Sam, 8 runs on 14 hits, 2 errors for the Bulldogs, 2 runs on 3 hits and 2 errors for the Northwest Bruins. The Dogs, let's see, they scored how many runs in that first game? It was
11. First game of the series, yeah,
first
was 11.
Game of the series, 11 runs. First game today was
9
runs and then 8 more runs. Dogs have scored a lot of runs against a team that had only lost 2 games before this series. Now they've lost 3 in a row to a team I don't think they expected They probably came into the series expecting to have a big win.
We're 5-4 in region, not 5-4. Because we played 9 games. We can't be 4-4 and played 9 games.
Yeah, so you're right.
What is math?
Well,
what is math?
Well, I was looking at this on here, and I was wondering why you said 4-4, but I went with it. But yeah,
don't you know to never trust me? Especially when it comes to numbers? I don't work at a bank or anything.
No, you don't. Like, well, listen, 5-4. 5-4 in region play. The Dogs are over 500 in region play. And what's so important about this win, Sam, is that you look to the rest of this region schedule. You got, I mean, yeah, you're going to have to keep your foot on the accelerator. You got Southeast Whitfield in not next week, but the week after that, which is a series you should win easily. And then Sonorville that's down this year. So if the Bulldogs can win out, they can possibly clinch themselves a home playoff game. Region championship is kind of a distant possibility, but a lot of things would have to happen for that to occur.
We're just like my NCAA bracket right now. We are on the outside looking in.
Yeah.
But there's still life there. There's still a chance. Now, we're going to have to get some help from some other people.
Right.
We're going to have Heritage get knocked off a few times. We're going to have these guys get knocked off a few more times. We're going to need to get Central knocked off a few more times. So there is that possibility. But what I think you just want to focus on is continuing to win ball games and continuing to win those series. You'd love to sweep Southeast. You would love to sweep Sonorville. But you have to win the series. That's plain and simple. You have to win those two series, and this is a great way to get us ready to go into those series by sweeping Northwest here. Your final line from tonight's game: Northwest 2 runs on 3 hits and 2 errors. Cedartown ends it on 8 runs, 14 hits, and 2 errors. Cole Cochran would get the start for the Dogs. He would go 3 innings. He would give up 1 run, none earned on 1 hit, 2 walks, 3 strikeouts. Jay O'Neill, a very similar line: 3 innings pitched. 1 run, not earned, 1 hit, 3 walks, and 2 strikeouts. And then Owen Pilgrim would come in, and although it would be rocky to start, he would close things out, allowing just 1 hit and walking 1.
I was just checking West Georgia TV, and looks like in the bottom of the 6th inning in game 2, Central leads Heritage 7-2.
So that's great. We need those two teams. And you know, each team has a win in that series now.
Yes.
So they've kind of beat up on each other, which is what we've needed. We need Central to pick up some wins against Heritage because, of course, Heritage is leading the region. But it also didn't hurt, though, that Central lost because they're also doing pretty well in region play. So we need Central to lose some as well. So those two teams beating up on each other was great. But tonight, it was the Dogs that beat up on Northwest Whitfield. They complete the series sweep, game 1 by a final of 9-4, game 2 here tonight by a final of 8-2. A great night of baseball, a great day of baseball, a great weekend of sports. You got Sweet 16 action finishing up tonight. You'll have the Elite 8 that'll start tomorrow. Those games will be played Saturday and Sunday. The Georgia Bulldogs and the NIT. Also, the women's bracket, South Carolina escaped. Their chance of a national championship still alive. So a lot of good sports for you. They're playing golf out in Houston. They're racing NASCAR somewhere this week. I'm not sure where they are, but just an absolutely great weekend of sports. And, of course, it's Easter. So, you know, we all of us here at the Big AA want to wish everybody a happy Easter. We hope that you're able to spend time with your family and remember the reason for Easter. And I hope you get to church on Sunday morning, even if you're only an Easter and Christmas kind of folk. You know, be there and remember the reason and all that and spend time with your family.
Yeah, that's right. And remember the reason, of course, is the death, the burial, and the resurrection. And that's what we celebrate on Easter. By the way, real quick before we leave you, Central put another one on the board. It's 8-2 in the bottom half of the 6th inning. So we'll be watching that ball game. And next week for Sports Talk, we'll have some – wrap up of this ball game. Hopefully, We can get some clarity on the standings at that point and see where we're at, as we're kind of about halfway point in region play. But a great game. Final score, Cedartown 8, Northwest Ruins 2, as they sweep the series. Our next baseball broadcast will be next Thursday. Sam Branch will be at Lake Point Radio only for that ball game. First pitch, 7 o'clock, Cedartown versus Woodland. We hope you'll join us on the Cedartown Bulldog Sports Network. Tyrone's back at the radio station. He's Sam Branch. I'm Andrew Carter. Good night, and God bless, and as always, go Dawgs.